I'll ask the clerk to read the motion.
That this Assembly expresses its concern that, according to the Department for Communities, around 376,000, or 21% of people in Northern Ireland, live in relative income poverty before housing costs. Notes that in June 2015, the High Court found that the Executive had breached a legal duty by failing to adopt an identifiable strategy setting out how it proposed to tackle poverty, social exclusion and patterns of deprivation based on objective need. Further notes that the Programme for Government consultation document published in October 2016 refers to a new social strategy in relation to these matters and calls on the Minister for Communities to publish an overarching strategy and long-term plan, including budget allocations, which outlines specific targets and timelines to reduce poverty and deprivation and tackle social exclusion and ensures the application of resources based on neutral criteria that measure deprivation, irrespective of community background or other affiliation.
Thank the clerk, and I call Ms. Nicola Mullen to move the motion.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. It is with sadness that I rise to propose this motion, which has as its genesis the unacceptable and shameful fact that one in five people living here are living in poverty, that over 125,000 of our pensioners live on low incomes, with over 18,000 of those forced to spend their senior and final years living in severe poverty, and that according to the Department for Communities' own statistics, more than a quarter of our children, that means a staggering 122,000 of our children, are living in relative poverty after housing costs. What this means, Mr. Speaker, is that one-fifth of our population at every stage of their life is living in poverty. Babies are born into a life of poverty from birth, and they only exit from poverty at the point of death. I am only too familiar with this injustice in North Belfast, where many people come to my constituency office and share with me their struggles to make ends meet. The fact that they are forced to rely on the generosities of charities and on food banks. The fact that many of them are living with their children in hostels for indefinite periods, and so many, many more are living in substandard accommodation, literally choosing between heating their homes and eating. And all of this, Mr. Speaker, is having a devastating impact on their physical and mental health. Because a life in poverty is one which cripples your educational and your employment opportunities, and it literally steals years of your life. The facts speak for themselves. If you live in one of the most deprived areas in Northern Ireland, you are more likely to experience the horror of infant mortality, as infant mortality rates are 16% higher in the most deprived areas than in the least. Suicide rates are three times higher in our most deprived areas than in the least. Self-harm admission rates are four times higher in most deprived areas than in the least, and twice as many people experience mental ill health in the most deprived areas than in the least. And for both men and women, if you live in one of our most deprived areas, you face fewer years of good health and you face a shorter life expectancy. Mr. Speaker, if this reality does not shock us all into action, what will? Certainly, the new programme for government, the Children's Services Cooperation Act, for which Mr. Stephen Agnew deserves great credit, the draft Children and Young People Strategy, and the requirement for an anti-poverty strategy, following, albeit the essential legal challenge last year, does provide a new impetus for concerted executive action on poverty and child poverty in particular, which remains consistently high and consistently higher than poverty rates for working-age adults and for pensioners. But these cannot be parallel processes. There must be a coordinated and an interconnected approach contained within an overarching strategy if we are to seriously tackle poverty. The first and most fundamental requirement to achieve this outcome is for this overarching anti-poverty strategy to include a proper and agreed definition of poverty, consistent with international standards on socioeconomic rights, which reflects material deprivation and an income that falls below an adequate standard of living. This definition, and as a direct result, the long-term plan and the allocation of resources must, as this motion points out, be tied to neutral criteria that measures deprivation irrespective of community background or other affiliation. This definition exists, Mr. Speaker. It is exactly the definition provided by Justice Tracy in his ruling last year when the human rights NGO, CHA, with the support of the Public Interest Litigation Support Project, had to bring a judicial review to force the Northern Ireland Executive to adopt an anti-poverty strategy. Given the importance of his ruling, I hope you will indulge me if I read out just a part. The concept of objective need is obviously central to the statutory provision, the intention of which is to remove or reduce the scope for discrimination by tying the allocation of resources to neutral criteria that measure deprivation, irrespective of community background or other affiliation. However, you would be forgiven for thinking that this never happened, because the programme for government and the amendment tabled before us by the DUP today deletes and dismisses this definition and legal ruling. Perhaps the DUP will today share with us their rationale for this deletion, and it is a question for Sinn Féin today as to whether they continue to support the DUP in this deletion and dismissive approach. The truth, Mr. Speaker, is that you cannot address poverty without clear targets. It is because of the deletion in terms of Justice Tracy's ruling and the lack of detail in terms of targets and timelines and budgets that the SDLP cannot support the DUP amendment before us today. We do need targets. If we are to get serious about tackling poverty, we must have targets. And this is not just my view. It is the evidence truth to which all research and experience points. We are continuously asked by the DUP and by Sinn Féin, so what would you do? Let me take the rest of the time to delineate some of the critical interventions we believe are required if we are to prevent another generation being consigned to poverty. You cannot and you will not lift individuals and families out of poverty without enhancement of household income. It's as simple as that. And yet the reality faced by our poorest and most vulnerable is one of cuts to their levels of incomes when they are already struggling to make ends meet. This is thanks to an executive that has handed their fate to a Tory government who sees nothing but austerity instead of human impact. We need to have benefit levels set to meet a minimum standard that are sufficient to meet the income needs of families. And we need to ensure that when decisions are taken around benefit sanctions, that it is very clear that we measure the impact that that will have on the children in those families. That doesn't happen at the moment. Other targets which should be included in a robust, overarching anti-poverty strategy include strengthening employment rights, given that 45% of those living in poverty are in work. It must contain plans to keep people in work and help those who are out of work, including our disabled, to find work. Social clauses in procurement also have an important role to play. The provision of high-quality, affordable childcare is also critical, not only for the evidence benefits to the child, but the employment and financial benefits it brings to their parents and the wider economy through an increased tax base. And yet, we are still awaiting the childcare strategy. And in the meantime, excellent childcare facilities like that provided by the Women's Centre Childcare Fund, which also helps to empower mothers in areas of high deprivation, are facing the very real prospect of having to close their doors and turn those mothers in need away. If we are to successfully tackle child poverty, we need to have coordinated early intervention support to families in crisis, including those affected by bereavement, family breakdown, illness, and substance misuse. We need integrated early years support to help ensure that young people, children living in poverty, can reach their developmental goals before they start school. We need to reduce the costs of education. We need to reduce educational inequality so that children in poverty achieve as well as their peers and have an equal chance of a future without poverty. And we need to address homelessness for families with children by providing additional resources for housing. Mr. Speaker, the SDLP and the Ulster Unionists met today with the anti-poverty sector, and I want to thank all of those organisations, because there were many who came to meet with us today to discuss what needs to happen if we are to seriously tackle poverty. I think it's fitting if I end with a comment that had very much found consensus in the room, and it was very simple but striking. It's not rocket science. All the research is there. It's about implementing what is demonstrated to work. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
I call Mr. Christopher Stalford to move the amendment. The member has up to 10 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, sir. Mr. Speaker, I'd like to start with a quote from Seth Godin, an American entrepreneur. And he said that poverty is an iron ceiling, a ceiling 4 foot off the ground, a ceiling that forces those who live with poverty to spend their days hunched over on the edge of fear and humiliation. I think that's absolutely right. I think it's right that we, as elected representatives, understand and appreciate the moral as well as the political imperative that is placed upon us as the public's representatives to do all in our power to tackle poverty and need in our society. I want to respond to one point that was made by my friend Nicola Mallon from North Belfast. I don't put my faith in any Tory government to look after the people of Northern Ireland. I put my faith in these institutions and in all of us as elected representatives of the people of Northern Ireland to do the very best for the people who sent us here. I would say to the SDLP and to the Ulster Unionists that I feel it's a shame they lack the faith in themselves to put their hand to the wheel and join us in government and make a contribution in government to tackling the problems that she has mentioned in her speech. The programme for government is operating in a new way from previous programmes for government. The draft framework was published, and that gave people an opportunity to have their say on what they think should be in the final PFG. The final PFG has been put out for consultation, and that's reflective, I believe, of the different approach, the outcomes-based approach that we have considered in this House. I think that people welcome that approach. They welcome the fact that not only is the government focused on outcomes, and outcomes is vitally important when you're dealing with issues around poverty, but they also welcome the fact that there has been an increased opportunity, excuse me, there has been an increased opportunity for people throughout the country to have their say on what they would like to see in the programme for government. In 2014-15, the average weekly household income increased by 3% from the previous year to £420 per week, or £21,900 per year. The percentage of people in Northern Ireland in absolute poverty has decreased by 1% in the previous year. There has been a decrease in the percentage of persons in pensioner age in relative poverty in 2014-15, from the height of 30% in the year 2008-2009. Those are positive developments, and I think everyone around the House would welcome them as such. However, we must never be complacent, and we must recognise the scale of the problem that we are facing. 20% of individuals in Northern Ireland live in absolute poverty before housing costs. That includes 23% of children, 18% of pensioners, and 19% of the working population. I have been a public representative since 2005. I don't underestimate for one second the scale of the problem. I know, for example, as a representative from South Belfast, and other South Belfast representatives can attest to this, that in our constituency there are islands of deprivation surrounded by seas of plenty, and they can sometimes go missed. For example, Tochmona is included in the Upper Malone ward when it comes to the Noble Multiple Deprivation Indices. There are real problems in all of our communities, and I believe that everyone in this House, whether in government or in opposition, is determined to tackle them. I think it's important, Mr. Speaker, that we have accuracy in the figures. It is not appropriate to compare the Northern Ireland poverty figures with the rest of the UK on a before housing cost basis due to the different ways in which water charges are collected in Northern Ireland. I think the people who brought the motion understand that, and I would hope that they would reflect on it. Fuel poverty is an enormous problem. 42% of households live in fuel poverty. And that's one of the areas that I think the government, when the PFG is published, that's one of the areas that I would like to see the government focusing upon. It cannot be right, Mr. Speaker, in this day and age, that pensioners, people who worked all their lives, paid their national insurance, made a contribution to society, should be forced into a position where they have to choose between eating or heating their homes. That is wrong in an advanced industrialised society like the United Kingdom. The previous speaker mentioned the need for a multifaceted approach to tackling poverty, and I absolutely agree with that. And that's why I think it's important that going forward, the government continues to have a strong focus on job creation. Job creation is one prong in the battle to defeat poverty. The figures show that the households below average report showed that the risk of working age adults being in relative poverty is made starkly higher for people who are not in work. The difference between those who are in work and those who are not in work is 59% against 13% chance of falling into poverty. So obviously, I think one of the focuses going forward has to be on job creation, has to be on transforming the Northern Ireland economy into an outward-looking economy that can attract jobs and investment for all of our people, regardless of their background, as the motion refers to, for all of our people to enjoy and to benefit from. I think it is important to note as well that between 2013 and 2015, the government has enabled over 9,000 people to avail of £30 million worth of benefits that otherwise would not have gone to them through the benefit uptake team that the government operates. And that's important because I know many members from all parties will have constituents who come to them not aware of the benefits that they are entitled to. And not only does that money help the families in question who are entitled to it, but it also helps the economy because they're spending that money locally in local shops and providing a boost in that way. So it is right that the government helps people to access the money that they are entitled to. Nobody in this House, I believe, Mr. Speaker, is content that any of our citizens, least of all any of the children of Northern Ireland or the pensioners of Northern Ireland, should be left in a situation where they are in poverty. I come into politics to make life better for people. I believe that that is the case for all members around here. I believe that we are all motivated by a desire to do good for our constituents, to make their lives better and to improve their standing. And it's for that reason, and that reason alone, that I'm content to move the amendment on the order paper. Thank you.
Call Ms. Carol McKellen.
Can Colia, and thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. I suppose not really surprised at the tone in which the motion was opened up. I've absolutely no doubt, I don't think there's anybody in this Assembly who hasn't got concerns around poverty and deprivation, so I want to say that. But I just think there's obviously, you know, that why we are involved in politics in this institution all day long, I think there's an element to play in politics with this. I also think it falls short, to be quite frank, because it actually falls short in the figures, because it's all done on the measurement of before housing costs. And I also think it falls short in terms of, to listen to Nicola Mallon and I'm sure other speakers from the SDLP, and I don't know what the UUs are going to say, But certainly, it's almost as if I've never been in the executive, as if poverty has just occurred from May 2016. I don't believe that taking the approach of before housing costs, it actually effectively misses out on some 9,000 people who live in poverty and live in income poverty. And I think this is worthy of consideration. If we're really about tackling poverty and deprivation, the people who are behind the statistics that I and others have referred to as the top 10% of the most deprived, those you can find those 9,000 people within that. It's also important that I think, certainly in terms of one of the things that I found personally regretful about the opening of the debate was Sinn Féin didn't hitch their wagon to any Tories, never have and never will. And I just want to make that completely clear. Christopher's done it for his party, as is his prerogative. I'll do it for ours. And certainly, we were collectively adamant to ensure that the mitigation packages that were brought in as part of Tory welfare reform were to try and offset the worst impacts of poverty on people. We'll not talk about that, sure. We'll also not talk about the impact of partition. We'll not talk about that either. And one thing I think we can all agree on is that the whole notion of people's experience of poverty is particularly acute when you're looking at access to employment, access to childcare, access to benefits, access to facilities. And the premise in which the motion was moved was around the executive fulfilling its duty, 28A I think it's referred to, on bringing an anti-poverty strategy forward. Everyone knows our position, and this has been very, very clear. We support the fact that there should be and will be an anti-poverty strategy in the social strategy. I also believe that the amendment from the DUP, Christopher moved it. What I'd like to see in that as well is actually talking about patterns of deprivation, and perhaps the Minister and some of his summing up can allude to that, because I think it's very, very clear that as part of what we're in now, the consultation, particularly in the programme for government and in the consultation into a social strategy, anti-poverty strategy, what that looks like, that needs to be addressed as well. We also have to recognise that there's some levers that impact on poverty and deprivation that are not within the remit of this executive. For example, it shows that some of the greatest impacts, particularly on poverty, and I'm sure many of us have spoke previously, we'll do it today and we'll do it forevermore, particularly on the working poor, and that's really around tax and hard benefit policies are impact here. And you only have to look at the report from the Institute of Fiscal Studies entitled Child and Working Poverty in Northern Ireland 2010-2020, which sets out the rising levels of poverty here. And it's directly correlated to the British government's policies and approach into tax and benefits policies. The executive has already stated that it will bring forward a social strategy, and that will be in line with its legal responsibilities as a result of the outcome of the judicial review. And I, like many others, will look forward to ensuring that not even just the Department for Communities, but all departments need to ensure that their resources are targeted towards objective need. I'm sorry, I won't, because I'm coming to the end. No, it's okay, I don't need it. Thanks anyway. No, I really don't. So, but I also want to talk particularly around...
Ask the member to conclude.
I want to talk about ensuring that the legal responsibilities are brought forward as part of the programme for government. And on the basis of that, we can support the amendment from the DUP and will not be supporting the motion.
Call Mrs. Jenny Palmer.
Mr. Speaker, we in the official opposition benches take no pleasure in bringing this motion before the House. The facts are incredible. 376,000 people in Northern Ireland, a staggering 21% of us, live in relative poverty. 376,000 people, Mr. Speaker. That figure is larger than any settlement in Northern Ireland, bar Belfast itself. It's nearly five Bangors, it's around seven Omas, and it's more than triple Lisburn. The two parties in the executive have been lead parties of government for almost 10 years. And they may try to pass the buck, Mr. Speaker, as we've already heard from both speakers previously. They can do They can and do try to blame others for their failings. They will blame the Ulster Unionists and the SDLP. They will blame the Conservative government at Westminster. They will blame the Dublin government for poaching our jobs and investment. One day they will blame the EU for interfering. The next day they'll blame the impact of uncertainty over Brexit. The only one thing they do not accept is any responsibility themselves. The DUP and Sinn Féin are in government as a partnership, two sides of the same coin. They need to learn the lesson that with power comes responsibility. For 9 years they have had the power, and it's surely time they took some responsibility. Sooner or later, Mr. Speaker, the realisation will dawn on them that there really is nobody else to blame. And what they have delivered in the decade, and what have they delivered in the decade in which they have been in charge? Mr. Speaker, look at the most deprived areas of Northern Ireland. Time and time and time again, the same names appear. Mr. Speaker, how long will we tolerate these names standing on the most deprived lists? Even the High Court ruled that they had breached a legal duty by failing to adopt an identifiable strategy setting out how it proposed to tackle poverty, social exclusion and patterns of deprivation based on objective need. What we need is an integrated strategy to protect the vulnerable, one that looks at welfare, education, housing, health, justice, training and employment, plus the arts, leisure and culture. We must put people at the heart of the intervention strategy. I believe that we could learn some lessons from the Dutch model, which targets government spending at those most in need and seeks to move them out of poverty. We need to end the current reality whereby families find themselves in a revolving door of poverty. The most vulnerable need a voice in this debate, and there has to be a genuine will to achieve real change. Instead, the supposed flagship, the Social Investment Fund, was to be the silver bullet, their big idea to tackle poverty and deprivation. At the last few days have shown it has fallen far short of these aims, and certainly in terms of governance. No, I won't, I'm busy. First, they couldn't give 80 million away, and then when they did manage to spend some of it, it turned out that they were handing millions of pounds of public money to people who have attracted almost daily negative publicity around it. There has clearly been a major failing over the lack of transparency and openness in terms of which groups could apply for funding, excluding some groups and organisations who also have the skills and capacity to deliver. There has also been a major failing in terms of how costs such as management fees were paid out. Mr. Speaker, in my own constituency, I know the Minister is waiting for this, the Resurgam Trust is living proof that the Strategic Investment Fund can do great work. And as I know from my own experience, I cannot speak highly enough of the work that it has done. But sadly, Resurgam appears to be the silver lining in a very, very grey cloud. In closing, Mr. Speaker, the Executive needs to get serious about eliminating poverty, and the first step is taking ownership of the problem. We need a strategy and a long-term plan. It has to be detailed and it has to be effective in reducing poverty and deprivation and tackling social exclusion, and most of all, it has to deliver.
I call Mrs. Naomi Long.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I welcome the opportunity to speak on today's motion, which is calling for action and clarity from the Minister in terms of what he intends to do to tackle poverty and deprivation in Northern Ireland. From the outset, I want to make it clear that we will be opposing the amendment that has been tabled today, as I think it's simply a case of the Minister's colleagues trying to take the approach of the ostrich and just burying their head in the sand and pretending that these issues will be dealt with by the Executive's current approach. The data and figures reveal that there are a significant number of people in Northern Ireland living in vulnerability. Moreover, history doesn't particularly inspire faith that this issue is going to be alleviated anytime soon. I wish that it were possible that we could simply agree a motion between all of the parties in order that we could actually tackle the issue rather than engage in this kind of fractious debate. The figures that we have in front of us today reveal around 3,700 376,000 individuals, 21% of our population, living in relative income poverty before housing costs. That's an increase of 1% on last year's figures, or an increase of nearly 20,000 people living in relative income poverty since last year. Now, I think we need to take that seriously, and there has been some debate, and rightly so, in the Chamber already about how poverty should be measured and which measures should be applied. There are, of course, a range of measures that can be taken on poverty. However, I think the more important debate tonight is about what we're going to do to tackle poverty, because I think that's where the crux of the matter lies. The Northern Ireland Statistics and Research Agency highlighted in their June 2016 poverty bulletin that during the period 2014-2015, a quarter of children were living in poverty. Mr. Speaker, that should cause us significant concern, because whilst I agree with the member for South Belfast with respect to poverty amongst older people, we should not neglect the fact that poverty, particularly amongst children, has a long-term impact as well as an immediate one. That poverty will impact on their current health, their well-being and educational attainment in the present. However, it has been shown repeatedly that it will also have long-term effects in terms of life expectancy and employment opportunities. So it is hugely important that we tackle the issue of child poverty in particular. Section 28A of the Northern Ireland Act 1998 placed a statutory duty on the executive to adopt a strategy to tackle poverty, social inclusion and patterns of deprivation. This was then reiterated again at St Andrews, and since that time, year after year, we are told that the Programme for Government reports, programmes and so on will actually tackle the issue. To be clear for those members who have raised the issue of this year's Programme for Government process, we have not criticised the process that has been adopted by the executive on this occasion in terms of going for outcomes-based measures. We have been supportive of the process. However, we are free to criticise the programme and the content of that programme, and indeed the lack of content of that programme. The changed process does not justify why we would not continue to do what it calls for in this motion, which is to develop a strategy. As noted in the amendment, the executive was indeed subject of a judicial review in 2015. However, it should be noted what the court actually said. They noted that we'd use the basic template of the 2008 Lifetime Opportunities Report as proof that it had a strategy to tackle poverty and deprivation. Justice Tracy quite rightly ruled the executive was attempting to present an unfinalised and incoherent strategy to tackle a vital and important issue. I think that that needs to come to an end, and it needs to come to an end extremely quickly. As a result of inaction, we are where we are today. 25% of children, 35% of single mothers, 21% of working age adults now live in relative income poverty. Welfare reform changes, and some will dismiss the impact of the UK government, but it should be recognised, welfare reform changes have a significant impact on the executive's ability to tackle poverty. And so we need all the more an urgent and robust strategy in place to actually assist those who are most vulnerable, those who are economically marginalised, and to deal with social exclusion and deprivation. I want to see an action plan, a proper strategy, backed up by detailed targets, goals and budgetary allocations. And I am sure there is no one in this chamber who would not wish to play a constructive role working with the executive, not against it, to deliver a fair and more prosperous society for everyone. I believe that the application of resources based
to conclude her remarks.
I believe that the application of resources on neutral criteria is the right way to go and doesn't prevent us tackling pockets of deprivation. So I endorse today's motion, and I would call on the Minister to bring forward his strategy as a matter of urgency in order that we can assist him with his work.
Before I call Ms. Emma Little Pengelly, the member has up to 3 minutes.
Mr. Speaker, thank you. I just have to speak very, very quickly. I'm absolutely genuinely passionate about helping people break free from poverty. That's something that I have a genuine interest in, and I've had a genuine interest in that for some considerable years, not just as an issue, but I've also worked at it and tried to bring about a change in the way government does policy in order to bring about those positive changes that we want to see. I suppose the issue here is, why do we want to tackle poverty? And we want to tackle poverty because it has bad outcomes for people. Bad outcomes in health, bad outcomes in education, and negative impacts in terms of the happiness and healthiness of their lifespan. I just want to touch very briefly, because I do only have 3 minutes, in relation to a number of points that were raised during the debate. First of all, I want to speak briefly about the court case that was taken by CAJ. In my view, the challenge to OFM-DFM at that time under Section 28E of the Northern Ireland Act was based on their misunderstanding of the concept of objective need. And I think it's very important for us to consider that. In fact, they had a concern that delivering social change funds widened the criteria from simply 10% on spatial deprivation. And I, in fact, have been very critical of that approach of using spatial deprivation as the only criteria for objective need. And I want to turn very briefly to that. There is, of course, an obligation on government to distribute funds and services on the basis of need. We all accept that. And, of course, that need should be objective. But there has been traditionally an ignorance or misunderstanding as to what this actually means. Government distributed services in a number of ways. Universal services, targeted at families and family needs and individual needs, and targeted on the basis of spatial deprivation based on NISDR's multiple deprivation spatial indexes. The exact methodology deployed depends on what the objective or outcome is. It is right that health service targets the need and urgency of the individual. That is objective need. It is right that all children having an educational need get education universally free at the point of delivery. That is educational need. That is objective need. And it is right that those in poverty and unemployment get access to the same benefits in the same circumstances right across Northern Ireland. That is objective need, the objective need of the individual. What it is not is arbitrarily drawing a line of those areas in the top 10% in relation to the spatial poverty evidenced by the multiple deprivation areas and excluding all those above the line. That postcode lottery or criteria does not work save in circumstances as spatial poverty is proven to compound the negative outcomes or a necessary cluster of initiative clientele requires geographical targeting.
I ask the Member to conclude her remarks.
In conclusion, I hope that the Minister considers the issues I've raised in terms of objective need and members across this House start to see objective need on a much wider basis than simply spatial need, which was part of the issue in terms of the court case.
I call the Minister for Communities, Mr Paul Given, to respond, and the Minister has up to 10 minutes.
Mr Speaker, thank you very much, and let me thank members for bringing the motion forward today and give us an opportunity to engage on what is a very important issue. And I think it is fair to say that we all share the same objectives when it comes to tackling poverty and wanting to help people who need that help. Where we maybe differ is the means and the process in which we want to take that forward. So I take the point that Ms Long has made in respect of wishing to have a motion where everyone around this Assembly would be able to unite around this issue. And maybe that's something that the opposition can consider if they wish to engage, certainly with me, on issues that they want to bring forward by way of motions. I would be happy to engage with them, and if we're able to find agreed positions, then we can have agreed motions around important issues like this. That's something that I would actively consider. Yeah.
Perhaps when they're considering that, they would allow us more than an hour to discuss such a topic as this.
Yeah, well, the point's well made in terms of the ability to have a fuller debate around this issue at the end of Opposition Day business. But it is an offer that I will make to the parties in the opposition, because I do think we can agree on how we tackle a lot of these issues. But the opposition may not want to go that far in terms of engaging with government ministers and departments in respect of trying to get motions where we can avoid, I think, some of the party politics that inevitably goes on, and I understand that, in respect of trying to get one over on each other. But when it comes to issues like this, it may be better that we can find some common ground given the issue that we're addressing. So let me just get on to some of the substance in respect of the debate, and where I leave out some particulars that members have highlighted, I'll revisit Hansard and come back around more of the detail in that. But in respect of the motion that has been brought forward, I believe that the amendment is more worthy of the Assembly's support, and I would appeal to the opposition parties to endorse the amendment so that we can have an agreement then that's universal in this House in respect of this issue. The most recent poverty figures available are actually for 2014-15, and these were published in the Northern Ireland Poverty Bulletin. And this showed that 395,100 people in Northern Ireland are living in relative poverty before housing costs. That's 22% of the population. So the original motion actually underrepresents the scale of the challenge that we have to deal with. It's worth noting that over the last decade, despite significant investment, the overall number of those in poverty remains the same. For example, the proportion of the population in relative poverty today is exactly the same as when Alex Atwood was the Social Development Minister back in 2010. And that's why I believe that the approach that we're taking in the Executive's programme for government can make a difference. And this is where I part company, I think, where Naomi Long indicated that the Executive was continuing to do things the way we had been doing them before. And that's not the case, because we are moving in terms of this outcomes-based approach. Either we continue to do the same things the same way and we'll get the same outcome, or we change the way in which government does business. And that's why the programme for government is being taken forward in a different way. And whilst I recognise there's been criticism of that, I believe we need to look back at the way in which we addressed things in the past and ask ourselves why we haven't made the difference that I believe we all want to make, and hence the change. So it's designed to help deliver that improved wellbeing for all our citizens. However, members will be well aware that we've moved away from the approach of the past that saw us use a range of actions, targets, and then simply tick them as we went along. And that approach failed to reduce the numbers in poverty up to now, so clearly we do need to do something different. Part of the different approach will involve the publication of our first ever social strategy, and this will in effect become the executive strategy for promoting opportunity for everyone and tackling poverty and social exclusion. And I plan to bring Mr. Speaker, that to the executive in the coming weeks, and I suspect that it will address many of the issues that members have raised here today, and I believe go further. For example, it will identify those in poverty and outline specific interventions to support them. It will also identify those at greatest risk of social exclusion and, again, through specific interventions, look to further support them. And of course, we'll do this based on objective need, because I'm well aware of the outcome of the judicial review last year, so members can be assured that I'll address the issues that arose from that judgment. And I've been encouraged. I will.
Minister for giving way. It's just in the context of his comments, then that's also looking at the patterns of deprivation that were outlined in the judicial review of last year, and also in terms of this consultation and the programme for government. I mean, the Minister has said that we are going to use debates like this and other opportunities for members to come forward with alternatives that haven't been expressed thus far.
Well, the member raises that important point. Once we get this through the executive, it'll be out for consultation, and so there will be a lot more specific detail. Well, if we can address this point, I'm happy to give way, then we will go out for a consultation, and that will give an opportunity for members of the House, for the committee, to really drill down into more detail that will be available to members that I believe will hopefully address this. And just to pick up in respect of the issue the members raised, that poverty, social exclusion and the patterns of deprivation are all inextricably linked, and many of the actions then will have a cross-cutting effect that will be in the social strategy. And we do recognise that some individuals and groups have different needs and face different challenges. And to base then the strategy on objective need, we'll need to focus action where it's needed most. Mr. Durkin.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I thank the Minister for giving way and look forward to this new strategy. Could I ask the Minister if his strategy will outline specific targets and timelines to reduce poverty and deprivation?
Well, there's going to be a lot of specifics in terms of the interventions that are going to take place. So members won't have too long to wait for people to be able to engage in the specifics that are going to be in the social strategy. So members will get the opportunity to do that. So I'm sure that's something that the opposition parties will welcome, and welcome that offer of engagement. In respect, let me make some progress, and then if I have time, I'll certainly give way to the member. I'm encouraged by the recent work that the Joseph Rowntree Foundation has carried out, and that suggests that our new approach to addressing poverty cannot be income-related alone, and a broader definition must consider the whole person and not just what is or is not in their pocket. And the programme for government is based on a similar whole-of-government approach that looks at multiple aspects of people's lives, reaching simply beyond income measures. And so whilst we will be clear about how we measure poverty, we need to recognise that in seeking to address it, there cannot be a one-size-fits-all approach We also need to be realistic about what we can do as a devolved administration. And there is no silver bullet in respect of this issue, and our opportunity to intervene in many cases will be limited. However, we've already shown as an executive that we can and will intervene to protect those in greatest need when required, and our welfare reform mitigation schemes are just one example of the difference that we can make. So the contributions that members have made, and I'll give way to Mr Atwood in a moment, Mr Stalford had raised an issue in respect of fuel poverty, and again, this is something where the Affordable Warmth Home Scheme targets households most at risk of fuel poverty, and it does provide a range of heating insulation measures, and that improves energy efficiency of households that have an annual gross income of less than £20,000. The new targeted scheme replaced the Warm Home Scheme from April 2015, and Jenny Palmer, my colleague from Lagan Valley, highlighted again a number of the issues around this. And let me say, I welcome her comments that she's made. I know she was there at the Resurgam Trust Annual General Meeting last week, as was the Alliance, Trevor Lunn, and the Alliance councillors. Unsurprisingly, given the good work that Resurgam do carry out, all of them, I think Trevor Lunn had to leave early, were more than willing to get photographed with the individuals involved with Resurgam Trust. And so I think it is something of note that the Ulster Unionist Party, through Jenny Palmer, are now making it clear that the Social Investment Fund does do good work, and that is recognised, and there are excellent examples of that. And I hope she will be able to prevail within her party in respect of the way in which she has spoken about what is excellent work. And we will see a new facility being opened in Old Warren that has been funded solely from the Social Investment Fund. Mr Atwood.
One issue I'm struggling with is, given that you seem to accept objective need and accept Judge Tracy's ruling in July of last year, why has the DUP and you not accepted what the judge explicitly said, and this is a question also to Sinn Féin, that the concept of objective need and statutory provision is to remove or reduce the scope for discrimination by tying the allocation of resources to neutral criteria that measure deprivation irrespective of community background or other affiliation. Why not say today that that's going to be part of the social strategy? Say it.
Time
is
up. Time is up. Minister's time is up. The Minister may consider replying in writing to the member. I call Mr Adrian McQuillan to wind on the amendment, and the member has up to 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr Speaker. I rise in support of the amendment, and this is a very important topic which I must speak in favourable terms of the actions of the Executive as demonstrated in the recent programme for government. It is also worth pointing out that the signatures of an original motion were members of the Executive of the last Executive, so it is therefore important to point out that figures quoted in the motion relate to the time when their own parties were members of the Executive. Nevertheless, this is a very important issue, and one which we need to see tackled, as I am confident the Minister is committed to doing so. The scale of poverty in Northern Ireland is much as the same as has been in excess of the last 10 years. It is worth pointing out that Northern Ireland is no worse off than England, where the majority of our nation's population live. Wales comes out the worst, and Scotland better than the rest. Certainly will.
I appreciate the member giving way.
Hey, we've had a reasonable debate for a reasonable length of time. Would the member agree with me that it's totally disappointing and wrong that the chairman of the committee, the co-leader of the opposition, couldn't find it within himself to be present for a debate on poverty?
The member has an extra minute.
Thank you, Mr Speaker, and I do thank my colleague for raising that point, and I was sitting thinking the very same thing while we were debating the subject. In my own constituency of East Londonderry, as of August 2013, 23% of children were deemed to be living in low-income families. East Londonderry ranked the fifth highest out of all 18 of the Northern Ireland constituencies. This is therefore an issue I am keen to see tackled, and as I believe that no child should be left behind. Poverty is primarily based on income levels, which is dependent on the availability of jobs coupled with the level of skills and qualifications held by the local population. Age and how healthy our population is, for example, having a disability can obviously impact on someone's ability to work and their life chances. Unfortunately, we have somewhat of a postcode lottery, as your income can depend on where you live and the number, as well as the types of jobs available locally. In East Londonderry, we have been hit by job losses, as has everywhere else in Northern Ireland during the economic downturn. This, of course, has an impact on the standard and the cost of living, especially as we see prices of essential goods rise. One way to help reduce poverty is through promoting benefit uptake, and I'm pleased that between 2013 and 2015, benefit uptake has increased due to the work of the department, with an additional $30 million generated for 9,000 people. I therefore would encourage anyone to check their entitlement to benefits. The executive placed tackling poverty and social exclusion at the top of their agenda. Poverty and social exclusion are mentioned throughout the programme for government, and perhaps those on opposite benches should take a look at it for themselves.
Would the member give way?
Yep, go ahead.
Would the member agree with me that we've heard some conversation around the chamber today about the court case, that the court case in fact recognised the plethora, and I think it's a direct quote to say, the plethora of anti-poverty initiatives and the actions taken by the executive in the last mandate under the last programme for government to tackle poverty, not just income poverty, but educational, health and other associated poverty. The court case recognised that the case was lost simply on the definition of strategy, not on the basis of objective need in that definition, but on the basis of the dictionary definition of strategy alone, and it did recognise the valuable work that the executive had already been carrying out.
Yeah, I certainly do agree with my colleague here, and she's far more qualified to speak on behalf of the judicial than I am. The key means of tackling these issues in the job creation is the way of our executives being active in promoting Northern Ireland abroad as a place to do business. However, one issue is ensuring fairness and equality in the distribution of the new jobs has been identified by the executive. Look forward to the publication of the first ever social strategy for Northern Ireland in the coming weeks, and this will clearly set out how the executive will tackle the very issue that impact on poverty. It's worth pointing out the special edition of the Oxford Review of Economic Policy, published in 2013, looked at the record of the new Labour in tackling poverty. It concluded that when New Labour put additional resources into tackling the issue, what matters is that how you spend money is more important than how much you spend. Governments need effective means to establish what works and what doesn't, and patience to see whether policies bear fruit in the long run. This is something I believe that the new social strategy will do. I support the motion as amended.
I call Mr. Mike Nesbitt to conclude on the debate on the motion, and the member has up to 10 minutes.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Tonight we discuss poverty, but as some members have mentioned, you cannot do that in isolation without talking about the creation of jobs, and good jobs, well-paid jobs at that. So we should tonight, I believe, be talking about not just poverty, but productivity and indeed prosperity. And I think the problem for the government in terms of prosperity is defined in their own budget document, where they talk about the prosperity gap between Northern Ireland and Great Britain, as measured by gross value added. The document makes clear that our GVA per head has remained consistently at around 75 to 80% of the UK average. In other words, if one of our citizens has a 75 to 80p in their pocket, a citizen in GB has the full pound. And indeed, the gap closed to its narrowest in 2007, the very year the DUP and Sinn Féin took over the heart of our executive government. I think, as your friend, the Minister for Education, made clear earlier on, we've heard enough from you, but I do welcome the intervention from the member from South Belfast earlier on, that bizarre mix of kind of Sinn Féin ourselves alone and D-State-esque, I don't trust Her Majesty's government. Nicola Mallon has made clear the rather shocking statistics with regard to poverty, not least suicides and mental health in her constituency. And I know the parties of government like to say to the parties of the opposition, well, what are your ideas? Well, on mental health, I have been shouting loud and long that we need to do more. And last week I was in London and I took the opportunity to take the issue to the Prime Minister, Mrs. May, who heretofore was unaware that per capita we may have the worst rates of poor mental health and well-being in the world. And one of the significant reasons why our rates are so bad is because it is a legacy issue of our troubles. And of course, Her Majesty's government have set a precedent of providing funding for legacy issues with £150 million for truth, acknowledgement and justice within the Stormont House agreement. So the precedent is set. It's not covered by the block grant. There are no Barnett consequentials. And I have asked Mrs. May to consider intervening to help with mental health, which impacts on poverty. But Ms Malin gave us the stats, and I noticed that the DUP amendment tries to airbrush statistics out of the equation. They would rather note the latest edition of the Poverty Bulletin rather than express concern, as we do, that 376,000 people, or 21% of our population, live in relative income poverty before housing costs. Now, I know the Minister says that we're going to do things differently in this mandate, and particularly in terms of outcome-based accountability. And we've had two documents, the second one currently out to consultation. But we must end eventually at the point where there are delivery plans. And they must, I believe, otherwise I believe the government will end up back in the High Court. Those delivery plans must take on the shape of strategies. And Justice Tracy was very clear about defining a strategy. He quoted the Oxford English Dictionary, a strategy, a plan of action designed to achieve a long-term or overall aim. It has to guide. It has to set a course. It must therefore be implicit in the idea of a strategy that strategy must be identifiable, it must be complete, it must have a start, it must have a middle and an end, it must aim to be effective, and the effectiveness must be capable of measurement. And the actions which are taken in attempting to implement that strategy must be referable back to that overarching strategy. In other words, stakeholders must be able to lift the strategy and measure the effectiveness of the delivery of government with regard to these issues. Now, I understand that the Minister and the Executive will publish a social strategy. I believe this is going to come towards the end of this calendar year or early in the next. But I also noticed that the NISRA, the Northern Ireland Statistics and Research Agency, only today have opened a consultation on multiple deprivation measures. They wanted to go if we should stick with the seven we have, namely income, employment, health and disability, education, skills and training, access to services, living environment, and crime and disorder. I would be very happy to give way to the Minister if he could explain to me whether the publication of the social strategy will wait the conclusion and the report of this consultation by NISRA, because the consultation is open until the 15th of January. So will we get the results of that before you publish your strategy, or will we have disjointed government where we're publishing a social strategy when the measurements that NISRA will apply may well change? Would the Minister care to address that issue?
Well, obviously we're at an advanced stage in respect of the social strategy, but the social strategy will be going out for consultation, and therefore if there's further information that becomes available, of course that will feed into it. But the Member seems to be labouring on a range of points to do with recognising need and poverty. I know that that need exists. I don't need to go and stay in someone's house that lives in the housing executive to get a grasp of the needs that there are in our community.
Well, I'm grateful to the Minister. I'm not entirely clear then on when we're going to get the publication of this strategy, social strategy, but we shall await the outcome of the consultation on both the social strategy and the NISRA research. The Minister, by the way, I note, says we should be working together and his door is always open. The last time I asked for a 5-minute meeting with the Minister was too busy to see me. And it was an issue in terms of tackling deprivation in an area of multiple deprivation in Belfast, but so be it. And on the Social Investment Fund, I do wish that some members of the government and the government parties would realise that life is not binary. It's not black and white. You don't have to be entirely pro the Social Investment Fund or entirely against the Social Investment Fund. What you can be is totally against poverty in our country. And I think Jenny Palmer summed it up very well by taking those raw statistics and telling us it's the equivalent of 5 Bangors or 7 Omas or 3 Lisburns. Mr. Speaker, I fear the results will be the result. I fear that when we bring forward motions, the parties of the executive simply wish to attack the opposition for attacking the opposition's sake. Mr. McCartney seems to regret we've only got an hour for the debate, but I would say to Mr. McCartney, the time allocated for opposition days is set by the business committee in which you and the DUP have the majority of votes. So we would very happily have a five-hour opposition day, or a five-and-a-half or a six-hour opposition day. We had three debates today. This happens to be the last. We were outvoted, and that's your democratic mandate to do so. But I do suggest that, having won the vote in the business committee, it is a bit rich to come back and then criticise us for not having enough time, because we're using all the time that is available to us. So, in conclusion, Mr. Speaker, we will not be supporting the amendment which tries to airbrush out some important issues, not just the statistics, but also the definitions brought forward by Justice Tracy in his High Court ruling in June of last year. And I know the Minister wants everybody to coalesce around a single vote. Well, I encourage him and the parties of government to coalesce around the motion. I think that would be a reasonable request.
Members, the question is that the amendment standing on the Marshall list be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
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 Aye.
Clear the lobbies. The question will be put in 3 minutes. Members to resume their seats. I ask members to resume their seats. I ask members to resume their seats. The question is that the amendment standing on the marshal list be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
Do we have tellers? Order, order, order. Tellers have been appointed as follows. Tellers for the ayes, George Robinson and Adrian McQuillan. Tellers for the noes, Mike Nesbitt and Nicola Mallon. Clear the lobbies. The Assembly will divide ayes to my right, noes to my left. Secure the doors. Secure the doors. Members resume their seats. The members resume their seats. The members resume their seats. Clerk, can I ask you to read the result?
87 members voted, 56 members voted aye. 31 members voted no. The amendment is therefore agreed.
The amendment is agreed. The question is that the motion as amendment, as amended, be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have.